week's program, we're going to be talking about a whole lot of things, including phosphate and where it is and what it should be doing and what in many cases it's not doing. We're also going to be talking to Kerry Burke, as in Sir Kerry Burke, and Warwick Green will be coming in to talk about the first 10 years with Seedforce. But in just a moment, is Dennis Carter. Got to be, Dennis, some good positive news around.
Well, you look for it, Rob, where you can find it. And there are some things that are pluses for farmers at the moment. And fuel prices down, which is good. Fertiliser down, which is good. The fertiliser companies are being quite responsible and not storing it away for rebates later on. They're giving it up front and, yep, and dropping their price, which is great. Interest rates are down and possibly fall further. Inflation's down. And, of course, the stronger dollar. So in theory, where we are buying things like fertilizer and fuel from overseas that with a stronger New Zealand dollar, that also should mean that it comes down further in the future. Whether those sellers of those products can afford that to happen, I'm not too sure, or pass it on. But everybody's looking at the moment at who's passing on and who's not passing on things like the reduction in the OCR with the banks. And so that sort of thing's happening. But the other thing that gives farmers a little more flexibility than they had in the last great, what I call almost depression, 88, 89, where interest rates were around 22%, that really meant that farmers didn't have the flexibility with their income. The majority of their income, or their spendable income, was going to the banks, just grab it first, left very little back to do anything with anybody else. This time, you know, we're looking probably about, you know, 5, 6, 7, 8, possibly up to 9% on overdraft. So that percentage of their income shouldn't be just automatically disappearing to the banks, giving them more flexibility. But certainly the banks and like the IRD, they want it straight away. But perhaps with the IRD this year, there'll be a lot of tax credits come back, and farmers will live on those, I imagine.
Exactly. Very dry, so fire risk?
Extremely dry. And as at 8 o'clock yesterday morning, Selwyn District Council imposed a total fire ban, meaning no even burn-offs with permits, just not issuing any permits whatsoever. I did notice a stubble fire yesterday as the ranger and the fire brigades and everybody else would have, I don't know how many 111s would have gone out for that one, but a farmer missed the information by a day. But in saying that, not all farmers do have texts and phones and computers and things like that, and it has to happen. The information flow has to happen, and there'll be a lot of farmers out there who did not know, and of course, that's no excuse.
No, it's not. No, it's not. What are the autumn crops like? Because it is very dry and you're putting it into dust.
Well, that's right. Farmers really, in trying to rush in and prepare their soils and things for the autumn sown crops, need to be aware of every time they touch the soil, they're drying it out, especially if it's blowing and the sun's out. It's going to disappear very quickly with running cultivators through it. So keep the roller there, be conscious, or even go the other way and go minimum till or direct drill just to conserve that moisture. Just think of what the Australian farmers do.
Exactly, and that would be prudent because Roundup's getting a bit low in price, which is nice.
Yes, well, it's always a good product and a good choice rather than cultivating weeds and grasses and things out is to kill it, leave it in situ and conserve that moisture that was there and direct drill it. And that's the beauty of Roundup without its residue being left behind is to don't disturb it, albeit that as long as the paddocks are reasonably level. And of course, if irrigators have been putting great gouges in the fields, a bit difficult to direct drill.
Cluster flies.
Cluster flies look like they're an annual event. They've been with us for about 18 years. It came from Europe. And they've found a wonderful host in our earthworms. They parasitise our earthworms, so they lay their eggs in the soil and they hatch into maggots. They progress through the soil, find an earthworm, and they inhabit the earthworm and live in the earthworm.
Ooh, sounds like science fiction.
It is. It's horrible. It's horrible. I haven't seen a movie of it. Maybe David Attenborough will come up with
one. Probably will, actually. Yeah, the dear
this
old
is what
boy.
Happens. And, of course, they hatch at this time of the year and are seeking shelter before the onset of winter, tend to get into buildings high in the eaves and through masonry and things like that, and they are revolting, dozy things that are quite hard to kill.
Yeah, exactly. Yep. White butterflies are bad this year.
Very, very bad. And people have said to me, you know, what's it with the white butterflies? Why are they so bad? Well, they, of course, have found a wonderful host in all the forage brassicas that are out there, along with the grey cabbage aphid and lots of other little grebes, looper caterpillars and those type of things. Because a lot of forage brassica crops are not sprayed as a horticultural brassica would be sprayed, or an agricultural brassica would be sprayed, because they're grown for on a low cost basis, and so they have found wonderful hosts there and just proliferated. But there is, keep an eye out, there is another bad white butterfly, about a very large one. It's called the giant white butterfly, and that's very, very destructive. It's been found in Nelson, and that's one that amongst all those white butterflies, just see if there's some giant ones. And
if there is, extra big ones, sort of do white butterfly on steroids.
Absolutely, do something about it, because they are really, really bad, really destructive.
Yeah. We've said it's dry. How bad is it?
Well, just come back from North Canterbury on Sunday, and there's not even stalks there. It's just bare soil, and farmers have depopulated their stock, and so it's quite sad. And trying to establish crops, farmers are having to irrigate bare soil before they plant to ensure a good strike, and got to be careful coming back in with irrigation again on very, very small plants, because you can you can turn the soil hard. But there's a sort of a low out there at the moment, and they're talking 15 mils of rain. Well, that'll be welcome, but it needs to be over a period of time and followed up with something else, because...
Yeah, nice and gentle too.
It's just disappearing just so quickly.
Exactly. Yeah. What's this new velvet leaf thing?
Velvet leaf is one of the worst agricultural weeds in the world, and it's come into this country at this stage, only been identified in fodder beet seed in two different varieties, and it does show itself well above the crop, but it is a real problem and has come in as a contaminant within that seed. It's been found in Canterbury, Otago and Southland, so just those farmers who are growing fodder beet, they probably all have heard about it now. But just
if you are one of those two varieties.
Yeah, don't pull it out. Contact the MPI and they'll deal to it, or the wholesaler of the seed or retailer of the seed, and they'll know how to get onto it and look after it, because we've got enough bad weeds. We don't need any more.
Absolutely, Dennis. Thank you very much indeed. In just a moment, we're going to be talking phosphate, what it's doing and how it's doing it. Now, phosphorus, or phosphate as it's also known, is there a bit of a world shortage?
Well, there's not so much of a shortage, it's more of a, there's been a bit of a shake in the market, if you can put it that way. That it's, as I say, after the Second World War, if you look at the price of phosphorus on the world market, it was essentially the same. It varied somewhere between about $200 and $250 a tonne, which actually meant effectively that with time it was getting cheaper. So phosphorus was actually relatively cheap as a fertiliser, and it's absolutely necessary. We import 1 million tonnes of phosphate rock a year into New Zealand, so that is essential to keep our agriculture running. But what happened is, I think it was 2007 or 2008, for a number of reasons, the price tripled in 6 months, so it went through the roof. And it really, that sort of sharp increase in price really focused attention thereafter on how much phosphorus was there available in the world, and when were we going to run out potentially. So then the concept of peak phosphorus came out, the same way that peak oil, they've talked about peak oil being. So there was an article that came out of Sydney, a university in Sydney, which actually used a combination of data and predicted that we would actually meet peak phosphorus as early as 2030. And this sent alarm bells through the system in terms of, people hadn't even thought about this before. You know, they thought there was phosphorus there and it was going to be used. It also meant that there was a lot of reassessment of resources. So a lot of resources that were uneconomic would become, at $200 a ton, certain mines are economic. At $700 a ton, other uneconomic resources become economic. So there's that to factor in. There's also the factor that at those sorts of prices, if anything could be sustained at those sorts of prices, there are all sorts of ways that the phosphorus becomes, all sorts of resources become available. The prices subsequently came down, but it hasn't gone back to the same levels. It's still about $100 US a ton greater than it was historically.
If we're using 1 million tons a year of the stuff, what are the world reserves like?
Oh, I can't even quote the numbers, but there are massive reserves. We're a relatively small user. It's just that we're very dependent on it, you know. In terms of places like China, Brazil, India, that was one of the reasons why the price went up, because their use went through the roof in terms of utilization. But as I say, what's happened then is that there's been a reassessment of resources, and the available resources have gone up. There's been a big move for exploration of new reserves, including Chatham Rise, undersea ones. And Chatham Rise is not the only undersea resource. There are other ones. For example, there are deposits off Mexico and Namibia, which are being investigated as well, which, again, previously wouldn't have been thought of as being economic. So the reserves estimate has gone up. But nonetheless, even if we're now pushing peak phosphorus another 100 years, which is still being debated in the literature, more than half of the world's phosphorus reserves are in one location, which is in Morocco, in Western Africa, in Northern Africa. So any resource that you've got, if you think of any of the major resources, you can imagine if 50% of the world's oil was in one place, one tiny country, it's a relatively small country, then that gives you scenarios whereby you could have variations in supply, which could affect cost, price. So you could have vulnerability or volatility, and that would affect all the way down the track to everybody. You know, so that the idea is that the way my take on it is that that price spike has been the best thing that's happened in terms of phosphorus for a long, long time, because it's meant that we appreciate it now. We've got a better appreciation. And the really good thing about phosphorus is that the vast majority of it that's put on in fertilizer, and most of the fertilizer phosphorus has gone on this country in the last 50, 60 years, the vast majority of it is actually still in the soil.
Yeah, I think it's about 90%, isn't it?
Well, as high as 90% in some soils. Some of it will be less. And we also used to talk about the concept that phosphorus wasn't moved in drainage and leaching. We now know that that's not true. It just moves to a much lesser extent than nitrogen, and it can create as many problems or allied problems with nitrogen in terms of water quality. And we're actually seeing that all over the world as well, in the developed agricultural nations, including India, Brazil, China. They're seeing increasing water quality problems associated with high use of phosphorus fertilizer.
Well, now, what about research on getting access to that 90%, or up to 90% that's locked in?
Yep, that's the focus of my research, and a lot of other people as well, is to actually mobilise and try and increase the utilisation of that phosphorus that's actually already there in the soil, that's been accumulated from previous additions. And so there's a number of different ways of doing that. It's mainly around biological means of doing it, by looking at different plants, at looking at microbes associated with plants, looking at microbial inoculants. And there's a lot of work, for example, I'm doing work in Chile, looking at volcanic soils, and they're looking at an idea of developing microbes that can be actually added with seed mainly, and to try and increase the availability. But there's a lot of other more simpler work if you can do, because plants are incredibly, plants and their associated microbes and the flora and the soil can be adapted to utilize better. There's also the issue of recycling as well, of trying to look at waste and trying to get away from the concept of waste I mean, in my opinion, that's one of my opinion, waste shouldn't. There are some wastes that are genuinely hazardous and should be treated as such. The vast majority of them, it's not a word. It should be a resource to be recycled. Like dairy shed effluent, it never ceases to amaze me that is just liquid fertilizer, you know? Yet it's the only time you hear about it in the media is when it's not disposed of properly. It shouldn't be disposed of, it's recycled. And that can save a lot of fertilizer. So there's a lot of things like that in terms of, and for example, in Europe, they're moving a lot in terms of trying to recover phosphorus from waste streams, in terms of recovering it and recycling it, you know, in terms of that, and actually looking at closing up cycles, even within countries or within continents, of trying to close it up. Another example is, for example, in North America, there's a massive disconnect there within the United States of grain production in one part and chicken production in another. So they move the grain from one side to the other because that's where the markets are, but then they've got this massive problem with the waste that's generated. So, you know, what do? We have to maybe get it back to where it's been. But that's not as easy as it sounds, you know, because that would involve moving the whole industry. But there are big challenges, and there are also challenges with a lot of, for example, in Europe, there's a lot of imported feed from South America. I mean, there's been this big boom in soybean, for example, production in South America. And a lot of that is going to Europe to feed animals, which creates a lot of nutrient, including phosphorus, which should actually ideally be going back, but I can't see them being that enthused about, you know, tankers of pig manure going back to South America, you know. But those are the sorts of issues that we have to address on a global scale. The other thing on a global scale is that, well, probably a lot of the world is actually more than ample in phosphorus. There are large parts of the world where they're very deficient, where production is being inhibited by lack of phosphorus. A lot of Africa, a lot of Southeast Asia, a lot of Central and South America. So there's that issue as well. And ironically, the things that we're trying to do in terms of improving utilization in high phosphorus systems can actually have applications to low phosphorus systems. But at the end of the day, in those low phosphorus systems, there's no substitute for actually getting more phosphorus in there.
Certainly some food for thought in that interview. After the break, it's Kerry Burke and a chap called Tim White.
Be Active begins here, in the cold, clean, unpolluted southern oceans of New Zealand. Be Active amino acid biostimulant, natural, 100% pure, manufactured from healthy deep sea fish from sustainable New Zealand fisheries. New Zealand's Be Active amino acid biostimulant, the way the world is growing. Working with nature, good for the plant, good for the planet. Now that's growing for good.
I've been reporting on farming matters on the radio and newspapers and on television for 40 or so years, but communication, like farming, has moved on. So we've come up with On The Land, online and through YouTube on any screen, anytime and anywhere. Just push play and see and hear what's happening today in our rural community. You'll learn and be informed about the latest and best information farming matters. On The Land, bringing farming information into the 21st century. So join us on our website, ontheland.co.nz.
You know that saying, content is king? Well, in today's mixed media world, it's true. You need video, audio, photos and more for social media, for marketing, for communications, sales and for advertising. And you need this at a price that works with your budgets. Well, that's what we do. At Tandem, we partner with you to create the content that you can use to shout to the world or video link to a few. Connect with us and we'll help you connect to the world.
We're living on a planet facing almost insurmountable challenges. Challenges we have to face sooner rather than later. The world needs our energy. She needs our ideas, our passion. It's up to us to change things, make a positive change to the planet, to feed the world, to protect the future, to live well, to be the generation that will make a change. Join us.
So, Kerry, we've got to talk about the American election because some would say it's a fiasco and others say it's an entertainment.
Well, it's a bit of both. It's their process. That's the way they run things. They have these primaries where if you support one party, register as a supporter of a party, you're allowed to take part in the primaries. And so the contenders within parties go hammer and tongs at each other, and eventually one emerges. But it is a bit bizarre watching the Republican Party seem to implode. Just seems, I'd be supporting the Democrats if I was living in the United States. But having said that, the Republican Party is the party of Lincoln. It's a great party, and it served the United States well, and therefore through that the world. But today it seems to be comprised of a whole lot of kind of different sectional groups. You've got the Tea Party. You've got some weird fundamental evangelical people. And there just doesn't seem to be the kind of cohesion there. And then into all that mix comes this rather unusual character, rather unusual hairdo anyhow.
Very unusual hairdo.
Who seems to be tapping into a chord of discontent. And from our point of view here, I mean, why would Americans be discontented? They're the richest country on earth. The average American income is higher than anyone else in the world. And yet, I suppose they just look at each other and see who's better off and who's worse off compared with each other. And so, all politics is local. And so you've got this weird amount of complete disenchantment in the richest country the world's ever seen. It's very unusual. And on the Democrat side, you've got someone who is on quite considerably to the left of politics against a mainstream candidate in Hillary Clinton. And for my aspirations as a citizen of the world, I hope that she is the next president. But who can tell? Who can tell? I mean, Reagan tapped into blue-collar Democrat voters. Can Trump do that if he wins? Or will the system try to stop him? My view, my preference for a Republican nominee is Kasich, always has been. I watched the early debates. He was by far the most sensible candidate, and I was interested to see the New York Times endorsed him. He's still only polling at 3 or 4 or 5%, but he's far and away the best of the Republican nominees left in the field, where he was even at the beginning. Mm. He's governor of Ohio. He's run a big state. He knows about government. He knows about coming to arrangements with the other party. He's done that successfully in Ohio, and he would do it in the United States as well. So my ideal matchup would be Clinton versus Kasich, and then the United States would get a good president, and we could all breathe a sigh of relief. Yeah. Whether it will happen, who knows?
Because Trump's a wee bit like a Bruce Cannon, isn't he? I mean, he's firing all over
the
place.
He's like a whole shipload of Bruce Cannons.
I mean, how can he get away with saying some of the things and upsetting whole segments of the population over there?
Well, he lost a couple of primaries in the last week. Okay, so is the tide turning? He's well ahead in Florida, and unfortunately, if he wins Florida, he gets all those votes, and that knocks Rubio out of the campaign probably, and that probably knocks Rubio's political career for six as well, because he's just a first-term senator. Florida's his home state. If he can't win that, Al Gore couldn't win his own state of Tennessee. That's why we got George W. Bush. If Rubio can't win Florida, then it's hard to see him making any progress at a national level again. And he's too young a guy for that to happen to. He's only in his early 40s. He had a lot to do if he'd just sucked in a few breaths for a year or two and maybe stood next time.
Are you surprised at the amount of reaction that New Zealanders are giving this American election?
They are very interested in it, and good on them, because it's a bit of theatre, isn't it? Really.
Yes, it is.
We haven't had this sort of entertainment out of the United States politics for a long time. I mean, Obama is a brilliant president, but serious, but still with a good sense of humour and a great debater. But I think people are interested in what's happening with the Republicans because of the total unexpected nature of what might come out next. Mm. Yeah. And from New Zealand's point of view, how will that matter for us with trade? Well, Hillary Clinton is slightly sceptical about the Trans-Pacific Partnership. That's appealing to some parts of the Democrat base, who manual workers especially, who are worried about competition. But as president, she probably wouldn't change very much. What do the Republicans feel? God only knows. I don't know. But surely we've got to have some position established so that our trading relationships are secure.
It's a bit scary. Feng Shui, apparently the black on top of the one of the options for the flag is bad feng shui, or whatever it's called.
Oh, okay, is it?
Yes. Okay, well, not supposed to have black at the top, apparently.
Well, did you check out that before you've had this table here or not? Because
yeah, exactly, we're between two doors. But anyway, the flag debate. I mean, once again, that's a bit of theatre to a degree, I guess.
Well, I suppose it is. Yeah, and I voted for the retention of the flag we've had. I think that it should go eventually. I suspect that 2040 is the best time for that. That's the 200th anniversary of the Treaty of Waitangi. Her Majesty will have passed away by then, as may all of us.
Yes,
who
yes.
knows? But that's the time for New Zealand to make its major constitutional changes, and I think that's the time for a new flag.
Yeah, I'm with you, and I've sent mine off, and I've said best pleas to the Union Jack in the corner.
Yeah, well, I mean, if Cameron can't control the British voting public and keep Britain in the European Union, Scotland will vote for independence. It will then vote to join the European Union, and so the blue will come out of the Union Jack one way or t'other anyhow.
Let's look very briefly at the European scene, because it's still chaotic over there.
It is. Yeah, it's definitely a there's definitely a major concern in Europe over the banking system. Especially Spain, Italy, maybe Greece, maybe less so for Greece now, but especially Italy and Spain. And there's not a lot really left that the European Central Bank can do, because the interest rates are now at zero. Big institutions with deposits are having to pay the banks to hold their money rather than, you know, getting paid interest for having the money there. So the bag of tricks which the central bank has got is for the euro is pretty empty at the moment. So the Brits are probably very pleased they didn't join the euro. Gordon Brown laid down a set of criteria which had to be met before Britain would consider joining, and they were never met. And now it's been pretty much ruled out by all party leaders in Britain. But there are, given the size of the European economy for the rest of the world, that's a major risk. And then on top of that, they've got to deal with these million or more refugees pouring in, and that's causing tensions between some of the newer members in Eastern Europe and the traditional heart of the European Union more to the west.
I mean, that refugee thing, it's been going on for so long now.
It has. I mean, it is. And you can see why people want to get away from Syria, and but Turkey, under its rules, is not required to maintain them or keep them. Funnily enough, Turkey's accession to the Refugee Convention was to deal with refugees from Europe, because it was a post-World War II thing. But they've come to an accommodation with the European Union, as it seems, and refugees are being turned back now.
It's an absolute mess.
It is a mess. You know, the one law you can count on in life is the law of unintended consequences, and I don't think that George W. Bush thought about things very much when he invaded Iraq, because the whole thing, I think you can trace the whole instability
right back to
that.
Kerry, thank you very much indeed for your thoughts. Very shortly, you're going to be hearing from the new sales manager from Seedforce. Tim, what's your role with Seedforce?
Well, Rob, my role is quite a new role. My role is a national sales manager with Seedforce. So my role there is just look after and complement the guys in the field and work with all our suppliers and merchants, and also work with all of our key customers and trying to, you know, provide what Seedforce does in the field and with quality seed options, but mainly about farm systems. So we're really about adding value to what our farmers are doing.
You've been in the industry for a long time.
Yes, I have, Rob. I mean, once you're in this industry, it seems to get into your blood and you don't seem to go far. I've had 16 years in this industry now, and started right back with Wrightson's Rural Supplies, and then through to Wrightson Seeds, and then from Wrightson Seeds I moved through to CRT Seed, and then latterly, in the last few years, it's changed its name, of course, with the merger of North Island and South Island businesses to Farmlands Grain and Seed, and here we are arriving at Seedforce. So, haven't gone too far away, and I've always sort of been involved in the city side of the business.
So what attracted you to SeedForce?
It's been something been on my radar for a long time. I like where SeedForce is going. I like their values. I like the fact that their business is not about seed. Their value is about farm systems and actually, you know, providing some different options actually out to the market out there than what we've been traditionally used to. And also trying to reinvest the or reinvigorate the pastoral focus for farmers back into their farms. In the end of the day, the cheapest feed that they can produce on their farm is the feed that they can grow. And there's a whole myriad of options out there. And so just looking forward to supporting that and helping some very, very key farmers get the best out of their properties.
And of course, you've pretty good relationships with the people that you're used to work with.
Yes, unfortunately, as I say, we don't always seem to shift too far, but yes, that's great. And that's the great thing, already known and already got some strong relationships with everybody. So it is very good, but there's also lots of new people out there too that I haven't met before, and I look forward to working with in the future.
In this present environment, farmers are looking to work smarter rather than harder.
Yeah, I think so, and I definitely think that we've got to open our eyes, the whole industry, and go back and actually look and say, well, if the ryegrass story is not working, then what other varieties, what other things in our forage systems can we actually use to complement what's been used traditionally?
And no doubt you've got a whole lot in the pipeline as well.
We have, Rob. We can't say too much, but we have. And I think that's one of the things that's really attracted me to SeedForce. It's very exciting. And with the Australasian business and also with the linkage back to RAGT seeds in southern France and you know, looking at some material that they've got over there, I think it's very, very exciting where we're actually going to go in the future.
So giving people the power to grow.
Giving the people the power to grow. I couldn't say it better than that, Rob.
Be Active begins here, in the cold, clean, unpolluted southern oceans of New Zealand. Be Active amino acid biostimulant, natural, 100% pure, manufactured from healthy deep sea fish from sustainable New Zealand fisheries. New Zealand's Be Active amino acid biostimulant, the way the world is growing. Working with nature, good for the plant, good for the planet. Now that's growing for good.
I've been reporting on farming matters on the radio and newspapers and on television for 40 or so years, but communication, like farming, has moved on. So we've come up with On The Land, online and through YouTube on any screen, anytime and anywhere. Just push play and see and hear what's happening today in our rural community. You'll learn and be informed about the latest and best information farming matters. On The Land, bringing farming information into the 21st century. So join us on our website, ontheland.co.nz.
You know that saying, content is king? Well, in today's mixed media world, it's true. You need video, audio, photos and more for social media, for marketing, for communications, sales and for advertising. And you need this at a price that works with your budgets. Well, that's what we do. At Tandem, we partner with you to create the content that you can use to shout to the world or video link to a few. Connect with us and we'll help you connect to the world.
We're living on a planet facing almost insurmountable challenges. Challenges we have to face sooner rather than later. The world needs our energy. She needs our ideas, our passion. It's up to us to change things, make a positive change to the planet, to feed the world, to protect the future, to live well, to be the generation that will make a change. Join us.
In just a moment, we're not talking drought, we're talking about how to get water off your paddocks. Phil, it's been a very long summer, but already people are starting to think about winter and getting water off the land.
Well, absolutely, Rob. You look at today, it's grey around, it's you're wondering whether in fact summer is over or not, who knows. We may have some particularly dry days yet. Well, we can be hopeful. But somewhere in the next couple of months, people are going to start looking at how do we drain some of these pieces of land. As everything starts to dry off, we start looking at moving into drainage. And we've got some very good product for that. For many years we've had DrainAway. The last 20 years we've been producing this product over here. And actually in the last year we've put on a lot of money in building new equipment for producing another type of drone away.
So this is all part of your continual R&D work?
Yeah, continual improvement. You know, we've had a very successful product for a long time, and we are now looking toward the development of that particular product range as well.
How does the new one differ from the old?
Well, the difference in this product is the corrugations are further apart. They're much heavier corrugations, and with the new equipment we're able to actually apply the material in the right way to the corrugation. And what that practically means is that it's a much stiffer product for us to put in the ground, which stiffness means that it's going to hold its shape in the ground, and actually it'll take the same sort of loading as the old product. But we've been able to actually get the delivery of the product much more evenly into the walls, which makes it stiffer.
So after 20 years of proven stuff, you've actually developed a new one.
Absolutely. You know, technology is always changing, and the effect of that is that we need to go with those changes as well. Some of the other things that are also happening is rather than punching the holes in the old drain away, we're actually now slotting the holes in the drain away, but we've gone to a very wide slot. So in fact, in terms of area of ingress into the pipeline, it's still very similar to the old product.
Phil, how do you get it into the ground?
Essentially, you look at the landform and you determine where the moisture needs to be. You trench it out, and then you make sure that there's material around the drainage pipe for the water to migrate out of the soil matrix into the pipeline, and then you bury it. And essentially, with a fall of about 1 in 100, 1 in 300, the water will actually pass into the pipeline, down the pipeline, and then into wherever you are discarding that water to, be it canals or be it other ways.
Do you put shingle around it, or how do you stop the soil getting into it?
It depends on very much on what the soil conditions are. Where you've got very heavy gravels and stuff like that, maybe you wouldn't need to. In most conditions, yes, you actually have to put some material around it. And what that does is that, this is especially true in clays and heavier soils, where we've got a slow migration of the liquid through that soil matrix into the pipeline, we want to get the best result. So we put essentially pea shingle and stuff around the pipe.
And there are people who calculate how much you need and where to put it, obviously.
Absolutely, yeah, there are professionals who are experienced in doing those designs, and it's very much about looking at the landform. So water will tend to shed from high down to low, and it's a matter of where you intercept that with laterals and where you actually run all of the other lines into that.
So there's many areas in New Zealand, like I guess Northland and Southland and probably the west coast of the South Island, all need this sort of stuff really desperately.
Oh, absolutely. There's certainly a lot of this product that goes into the Southland area for the South Island. The west coast, I think in lots of cases, it's so bad that in fact they tend to hump and hollow, simply because of the amount of water that you're dealing with is quite different. Lots of parts of the North Island, the Manawatu for instance, it's quite low lying, you have the Manawatu River weaving its way through to the sea. It's very flat land and it doesn't drain particularly well, so those are areas where they put a lot of drainage product into the ground.
Really, it's compulsory if you've got wet areas, because we need that wet area to be drained for production.
Yeah, absolutely. We're trying to get the most out of productive areas as we are able. If we can manage the water, either putting it on in irrigation, and Canterbury would be an example where we just don't get enough rainfall. And in areas like Southland, where they actually get too much rainfall, we can adjust the water levels in the soil and get best growth from it.
It's always good to know what's happening, even a simple thing like piece of pipe to get the water off is always being developed. In just a moment, we're going to go to France, or France actually comes here. Claude, you're over from France for the Seed Force launch, but what's happening in the Northern Hemisphere as far as seed is concerned?
Oh, we have a lot of change in the last 2 years, I would say. You know, in the seed business, we have some concentration because it's more and more difficult for farmers, and also so the money that we can make is less and less. So there is a general trend for consolidation in our industry and less players. And in that race, I would say, RGT is a little bit different. We grow, we develop ourselves, we continue to hire people and to develop programs. We have one of the specificity, which is that we are dealing with a lot of crops, and this is also an advantage for us in the time being, for sure.
So times are really quite tight over there.
I think it's tight for the farmer, so it's difficult for people like us because we are working with farmers. So we are happy when farmers are happy. That's the most important thing for us. But we continue to think that agriculture is a key sector for Europe, and we continue to invest, which is very, very important for the future. So we are quite confident for the future for a company like us.
All we hear about is refugee problems and whether the UK is going to stay in the EU. Mm-hmm. Does that become disruptive?
Yes, a little bit. So, you know, we have a long story between French and UK guys, so, and not only on rugby team, I must say, but that's a bit of concern at the time, but I'm pretty sure that UK will stay within Europe. There are so benefits for UK guys to be in Europe that I don't think they will exit. But the refugee is clearly a bigger concern for the future because, you know, we need to help these countries in order to fix the population, to have the possibility to develop themselves. Otherwise, we will have a lot of refugees for a while. So that's and agriculture also has something to do to help them to develop in these countries. Otherwise, we will have some problem in the future with too many people coming, that's for sure.
We think of European farms as being a lot smaller than a lot of New Zealand farms. How does that affect you?
No, this is not so much affecting us because, you know, we have this CAP policy. But this is a concern for the future. We see some concentration also in this area because the young people, they don't want so much to come to work in the farming business because it's too much work, and they won't like to have the same life than their colleagues or their friends. But we see more and more evolution concentration, which means that the arable land will still be managed. So for us, as we are suppliers, this will not change so much, I would say. But we support and we try to have new young farmers be installed on farm. This is important for us, that's for sure.
And obviously there's new crops coming on, or new cultivars arriving. Are they being taken up by the young ones?
Oh yeah, for sure. That's something which is very important. You know, in Europe today, we are paying a lot of attention about environment and so on. So the general public, they don't want to consume products which have been too much produced with chemical treatment and so on. So, and what do the farmer want? They want varieties which are good quality, easy to crop, not needing too much pesticide and so on. So this is typically what we have to do as breeders. That's the sense of our work, so that we are quite happy with that. And for sure, we are one of the best solutions for the future for agricultural farming in Europe.
After the break, we stick with Seed Force, and Warwick Green will be telling us about the first 10 years of that company.
Be Active begins here in the cold, clean, unpolluted southern oceans of New Zealand. Be Active amino acid biostimulant, natural, 100% pure, manufactured from healthy deep sea fish from sustainable New Zealand fisheries. New Zealand's Be Active amino acid biostimulant, the way the world is growing. Working with nature, good for the plant, good for the planet. Now that's growing for good.
I've been reporting on farming matters on the radio and newspapers and on television for 40 or so years, but communication, like farming, has moved on. So we've come up with On The Land, online and through YouTube on any screen, anytime and anywhere. Just push play and see and hear what's happening today in our rural community. You'll learn and be informed about the latest and best information farming matters. On The Land, bringing farming information into the 21st century. So join us on our website,
ontheland.co.nz.
You know that saying, content is king? Well, in today's mixed media world, it's true. You need video, audio, photos and more for social media, for marketing, for communications, sales and for advertising. And you need this at a price that works with your budgets. Well, that's what we do. At Tandem, we partner with you to create the content that you can use to shout to the world or video link to a few. Connect with us and we'll help you connect to the world.
We're living on a planet facing almost insurmountable challenges. Challenges we have to face sooner rather than later. The world needs our energy. She needs our ideas, our passion. It's up to us to change things, make a positive change to the planet, to feed the world, to protect the future, to live well, to be the generation that will make a change. Join us.
Birthday to Seedforce, Warwick, 10 years. It's been a very interesting climb, I would have thought.
Well, I don't know, Rob, the time's just kind of whoosh, and I mean, the 10 years has just flown by. Fantastic achievement. I'm just so delighted that, you know, on behalf of the company and the board and all of us, the shareholders, that we've been able to get to this point in time. I mean, we see so many stories in the press of companies that get over the first hurdle, which is a couple of months, and then they fail to kick on.
I think the interesting thing is that there's a quote that says, there's no escalator to success. You've got to take the stairs and step by step.
Exactly. And yes, we have. I mean, we had our celebration of 10 years of Seedforce, and it coincided also with the opening of a new building, which we've invested in to effectively go the next 10 years, hopefully, and that was last week, and it was a great opportunity. We were able to host not only our joint venture shareholders from France, from RSUT Jordans, but also a number of our customers and suppliers and farming producers, and it was just a great celebration to be able to...
Tell me how the joint venture works, because you're in there with the French and the Dutch.
Yes. Well, Jordans is the actual shareholder, but they're a subsidiary of RSUT, so they're fully owned. So it just so happens that they are the designated company to represent the French interests. It's a joint venture with local shareholders, of which I'm one, and largely... it's a partnership to develop and bring the best technologies from around the world, and certainly from RSUT and France, into New Zealand for New Zealand agriculture, really. Because farmers have got to have choice and farmers have got to have access to the best technology. And often we pride ourselves with sort of saying we know it all and we're a pretty good country and, hey, we can...
New Zealand here, we can beat everyone. I understand.
And... but the reality, Rob, is that investment in R&D is a huge expense. And we've seen it in New Zealand that I think our R&D expenditure is pretty low. RSUT, for example, spend a third of their revenue on R&D.
So really?
It's a significant investment. Of 1,200 people, they've got almost 400 in R&D. So... it's a significant investment, and we can tap into that and we can bring those suitable technologies to New Zealand for the betterment of agriculture.
Because what intrigues me, Warwick, is the fact that you brought back a whole lot of what I would say old traditional crops, but they're totally new.
Well, yes. I mean, I mean, for example, fodder beet, which we've talked over the years about, we've really bought an old crop, but we have bought a we've bought a technology and adapted it by way of how to use it. We understand its agronomy, but we've had to tweak it, and we really didn't understand how to feed it in the field, in situ, and that's been where the secret is. That's what we've solved,
and that's been done in conjunction with the likes of Lincoln University and some overseas people, and we've been able to bring that, and farmers are using it. And I mean, today it's a significant crop.
In fact, New Zealand is probably one of the main areas for growing it now.
It would be. Yes, it would be, Rob. It would be, yes, certainly.
And fescues and Coxford?
Well, you know, we've talked about resilience, and it's a word that gets battered around a fair bit, but in terms of resilient pastures, it's been a key focus for us. And look, we're not knocking ryegrass. Perennial ryegrass is great, and perennial ryegrass, white clover pastures have lasted for, you know, and stood agriculture in the mainstay. But when we're getting extremes, ryegrass doesn't like it. And so we need to bring more robustness into our pastures. So the likes of tall fescue, the likes of Coxford are both robust species. And there's been some significant breeding done by RAGT in France. They would have the world leading program in both those species. They've changed the softness of the plant. They've changed, in the case of tall fescue, made it almost look like ryegrass. And it's so much more robust in terms of much better root system. In terms of Coxford, quite different. Coxford used to clump and be seen as just a plant here and a plant there. Well, now that doesn't happen. And the modern Coxfords are grown just like a leafy pasture. And so farmers are integrating those into pasture mixes. They're using them as part of their overall farm program. And we're seeing some fantastic results. In fact, interestingly, the seed industry domestically does an annual survey of the use of proprietary species. And in the results that are generated annually, we've seen in the last sort of two, three years, almost a significant increase in tall fescue use and a significant increase in Coxford use. So obviously demonstrates that it's working. Yeah.
And you're very focused on palatability for a very good reason.
Oh, well, it's key. I mean, if the animals can't eat the particular forage, then we haven't really got a future because they can't put on live weight gain. So palatability, stock grazing, animal performance are all linked. They're all a very key component of basically how we produce meat and milk from grass and forages.
I'm going to be giving you just a bit of a, you're going to go humble on me, but in the last 10 years, I think you've advanced hugely the agronomy in New Zealand. Is there still room for more?
Oh, there is, Rob. I mean, I think modern technologies today are giving us a better measure of being able to quantify the benefit that we're getting from them. I think that's a key area. You know, there are a lot of new programs, economic modelling programs now that are able to show if you plant a mixture or a new variety or a new species and integrate that into your farm system, what will that generate in terms of revenue? I think that whole area, there's a whole area of understanding that many farmers don't have. They still fly by the seat of their pants and by the gut feel, as you well know. I mean, it's working, it seems to be working, but I can't actually tangibly put a figure on it.
No.
So I see a huge increase there. I think there will be improvements in time as new technologies come along. One of the key ones is marker-assisted selection. So what that means is that you could almost say that plant breeders can produce designer ryegrasses or designer grasses, designer forages. They know the blueprint of the actual plant, of the species, and they can identify all the good parts and maybe select out the bad parts. So you'll find in the future that they'll be able to breed almost like you bake a cake, breed to a recipe, and that's all driven out of things like sort of marker-assisted selection, which RAGT have got a significant investment in, and that's how most of their program is being developed going forward. So it's all the future.
And once again, congratulations on your first 10 years.
Thanks, Rob. Thanks very much.
Now, if you'd like to go and listen again and have another watch of the interview I've just done with Warwick, you can find it on our website, which is obviously called ontheland.co.nz. I'm Rob Coke-Williams. You've either been watching or you've just missed the program, but it will be back at the same time next week. Until then,